From BQE Restaurant and Lounge in the heart of Atlanta's historic Martin Luther King District, it's Newsmakers Live, bringing you the issues, politics, and perspective of the Atlanta community. Now in its 10th season, here is tonight's moderator and your host, 8-time Emmy Award-winning broadcast journalist, Mr. Maynard Eaton.
One of the things that I find so amazing about Kwanzaa Hall is that he's arguably the most popular city councilman, city elected official in the state.
They couldn't hear you on the mic.
Testing 1, 2. Can you hear me now?
Oh, closer, yeah.
But again, he's a popular guy, a powerful guy, and now he's set his sights on becoming Atlanta's next mayor. Why, councilman? You are really the glue that holds our council together, the most powerful, popular guy. Why run for mayor?
Well, I mean, I've been elected for 15 years, 2 years to serve on the school board, and the last, I guess, 11, 13 on city council. And, you know, we've been working really hard in Council District 2 to get things done, but I think the entire city deserves to have a leader who can bring all types of people together, from north to south, to east to west, black, white, gay, straight, it doesn't matter, as we've done in the heart of the city. And I would like to offer myself to service to everyone in Atlanta.
7 or 8 candidates at least. How do you differentiate yourself from, how do you distance yourself from some of the others?
Well, I mean, first of all, we have a track record for getting things done. No one else has done the amount of work that we've done in a council district or in the city in terms of actually delivering on touch points in public safety, transportation, economic development, education, workforce development, homelessness. There are more homeless individuals in Council District 2 than the entire city combined. Wow. There are 3 hospitals in Council District 2. The Georgia State and Georgia Tech are in Council District 2. There are more clubs, bars, restaurants in Council District 2. There are more hotels in Council District 2 than the rest of the city. A lot of shopping. So we've been really acting as a mini mayor anyway.
Acting as a mini mayor.
Basically, yes. The Carter Center, the King Center, the Aquarium, CNN, they're all in Council District 2. So when people can't get through to the administration, they tend to call our office. And sometimes it starts with small things and it ends up being big things. And we've delivered over and over and over, time and time again. And I just handed out this handout here that really describes the types of things we've done from a legislative standpoint, and then just getting things done on a day-to-day basis for constituents. And I think we've developed a platform and a customer service model that really everyone in our city deserves to experience.
Is this going to be a tough race to, again, distance yourself or win this thing? For example, Senator Vincent Ford said he almost guaranteed he'd make it to the runoff. That's, everybody's always cocky when you're in a campaign. Yeah. But there's a lot of folks out there with impressive records also.
No, it's a very formidable field, and we don't discount anyone in the race. I think they're all very serious contenders. They are smart people and hard workers, good people, but none of them have the track record that we have for legislative delivery. And in particular, even when you speak about Senator Ford, you know, we are passing legislation at the city around criminal justice reform. Even today, we discussed the decriminalization of marijuana. So there are people saying, when I'm mayor, I'll do it.
Right.
I'm saying, as councilman, I'm doing it right now. So, you know, there's a difference. You know, they have to look forward, and we're talking about today.
Let's talk about City Hall for a second, sir. There seems to be some distress over the specter, the smell of corruption at City Hall. $1 million bribery. It went to somebody. What's your sense of who that may touch and how far it may go?
Well, I mean, it's a bad thing. I knew E.R. Mitchell Sr., the father of the gentleman who just pled guilty, and he was a really good man. He was a pillar in the development community like Herman Russell.
Right.
He meant a lot to Atlanta when African Americans were not in development. So to hear this about his son is really disheartening and disappointing. And then to hear another gentleman to plead guilty is equally as disappointing, and it speaks volumes to the need in our city to still root out that type of corruption and make sure that we have transparency in these processes. But one of the things that was highlighted, and it's still an open investigation,
right,
so I don't know as much about it, and I wouldn't want to try to go too far out there, but I would say some of the allegations revolve around the emergency contracts related to
right.
snow. None of us could have predicted the snow, but there may be some additional procedures or protocols that we could add to that process. and have a fixed price on emergency purchases so that people don't have that leeway in the administration or down at the staff level to be corrupted and bribed to support that type of activity.
But there are some who suggest it also smacks of black politics at its rarest and ugliest form. Yeah. Mitzi Vickers involved, who's highly respected as a political operative. It does not look good.
The need for transparency and the need to address corruption is a worldwide thing. It's not local or germane just to African Americans in Atlanta. And in this case, there were two individuals, one black and one white. So this is not about black and white. This is about right and wrong. And what we
and about money.
And, yeah, about the money that was involved. And it's so unfortunate to hear about this, but you know it did happen, it seems, so we're going to have to address it. And from a legislative standpoint, the council can step up and do some things once we have the facts. Right now, we only have what's in the news, and all of that, I mean, sorry, no offense, but you know,
it ain't
media
fake news.
can change things and not have it absolutely accurate. And we want to hear all the facts and be briefed by our legal department ultimately.
You talk about Atlanta and knowing E.R. Mitchell Sr. But you were raised here, too. You had one heck of a dad yourself who worked with Southern Crimson Leadership Conference. Talk about a bit about your upbringing and who your dad was.
Well, I grew up in Southwest Atlanta. My parents were from Chicago. My mother and my dad was from Montgomery, Alabama. He was an organizer in Alabama, and then he was kicked out of high school for organizing in 1963. Civil rights organizer with Dr. King. He was the youngest member of Dr. King's staff from 63 to 68 and moved to Atlanta. I didn't know growing up that he lived on this side of town, in particular in the old Fourth Ward. Neither did I know when I actually ran for office that this was his neighborhood. And it was only when a good friend of ours, Marie Kauser, who's long gone now, but she let me know that my dad lived in Freedom House, which was on the top of the hill on Randolph. So, you know, it's kind of like God has a way of putting you exactly where you're supposed to be. I grew up in Southwest Atlanta. I went to Mays High School. One would have expected me to run in District 10, 11, or 4. Not in Council District 2. This was always a very diverse and different place. It was dense. It felt like New York. Didn't feel like the rest of Atlanta is very suburban. And 20 years ago, it was even less developed on our side of town. So, you know, I think my dad, you know, paved the way. And, you know, he gave his blood, sweat, and tears to our city and to this country, not only for civil rights and human rights, but also to get a lot of African Americans elected. He worked on Maynard Jackson's first campaign, the second campaign. He worked for Andrew Young on his campaigns. He worked with John Lewis. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. So he really did believe in the ideals of the civil rights movement. But when you're in that type of place and you go into politics, you find out that, you know, politics is a whole nother thing.
Right.
And when I was in college, my dad said, son, don't go into politics. And it took me about 10 years to understand that he meant don't become a politician, be a public servant. And if you're not going to be a good steward, don't be in it. And I focus only on stewardship and really trying to do the job that God has empowered me to do.
And I'm sure you'll be asked the question, especially in the age of Trump. Are you the typical politician?
Absolutely not. I mean, everybody knows the people in this room, and if you don't know me, spend a day with me. I welcome any individual. I don't discriminate. My district is so diverse that, you know, I'll have a felon riding with me one day, and I'll be with a president the next day. You can't treat people any differently. And that was one of the things we learned when we came into this office. You know, there are no big eyes, no little U's ever in life. But especially in District 2, when you have Bernie Marcus and Ted Turner and Coca-Cola and African-American seniors who live at Maggie Russell, who's more important?
Well, some would say most folks, many quote-unquote politicians, will go with the money.
No, I mean, not when the seniors vote.
That's true.
I mean, so, you know, as long as they're participating in the process, or when you go to a senior building and you discover that they're like your grandmother, how can you turn your back on your own grandmother? You just can't do it. Or you think about the families and children who live on Boulevard. Average income is $3,000 a year. Average rent is $12 a month. Just a couple of blocks from here. How can you turn your backs on them? You know, how can you not try to help them, even if they don't know how to get help from the system, if they don't think the city works for them? Because the city is only a sign of a school system that failed me or my children, or the city symbol means I'm incarcerated. You know what I'm saying? So there's a need for us to reposition our value proposition to those in our city, rich and poor, but especially those living most in the margins.
Well, now again, District 2 has the good and the bad, the rich and the poor. Marie Kauser, our friend who died unfortunately years ago, was a community organizer who helped clean up the boulevard area, if you will. Now, just below that, you can't get there. You can't buy there. The whole, where you live off of Edgewood Avenue, on the other side of Boulevard, used to be a ghetto. Now it's fine housing.
Yes.
Is Atlanta changing like that all across the city?
Absolutely. The city is changing for a couple of reasons. Well, we had a very intentional strategy and plan to revitalize 044, and it's come to fruition. But what people have discovered who have been caught in traffic, that's one of the biggest problems in our city over the last 10 or 15 years, is they'd rather be inside the city and not have to drive and have access to transit or be able to walk in a neighborhood. And there are a lot of very nice neighborhoods that were historically African-American
neighborhoods.
That now everyone is discovering, wow, the houses look really nice. The yards are large. It could be nice. It's just no one has loved it in a while. And there were former housing projects that were destabilized, that were closed down, that ultimately took away the community. So the store is closed, and no one lives there. Dixie Hills is a great example. What I want to do in my leadership is bring back a neighborhood renaissance, but a renaissance that is inclusive, that does not displace people who are still in these neighborhoods. Everybody that's there, we're going to lock them in so they can stay. And then we're going to build around and make it inclusive, and then also add a range of housing options. I learned a lot about how to do it right based on what we've done in 04th Ward. It's not all bad, because most of the stuff we built in 04th Ward was built on industrial sites. It wasn't built on houses that were taken or through foreclosure or anything like that. There were a few, but many people maintain their homes. But there are other parts of town where we are seeing the gentrification happening, and it's pushing seniors out, and families are losing their homes, and we've got to protect them. And it really is happening at a rapid pace, so I want to put a very aggressive non-displacement strategy forward, as we saw with HDDC, the Historic District Development Corporation, in the Old Fourth Ward and the King District. But that's
Ms.
one of the few places,
Young,
Youngblood and Marie, one of the few places that had that strategy. But the additional thing is, when you do raise the values, it gives you the opportunity, if the city is a partner, to do affordable housing in a wholesale manner. Because now you have desirability of place, people want to be there, and you have the ability to do denser development on sites near transit, especially, so that people don't have to have a car and pay that $400, $500 note for a car. They can use the train, or if they're ultimately on the streetcar or the Beltline route, they can use that to get around. So there's some opportunities for us to do this right in other neighborhoods, but it's going to take a radical shift in the way we've been addressing development, and we can't allow the developers to control the market. Now, right now, just speaking of development, so you understand, and the audience understands how much I know about this and how I have leverage, there are about 19 projects just in Midtown alone for $2.2 billion worth of development. Okay, since I've been elected, it's probably been $5 billion worth of development in my district. So I know almost every developer on a first name text basis at 12 o'clock at night if I want to talk to them, because I've helped them. But they also know what I'm saying about having affordability built in is very, very important. One of the developers was complaining to me. I said, hey, what happened to your daughter? She moved into Old Fourth Ward. He said, well, she moved to Bucket. I said, why? He said, well, it's gotten too damn high. I was like, man, you're the developers that are pricing your own families out. The market cannot drive our community. Atlanta's been great at building buildings, but not good at building people or designing for people. Cities are supposed to be for people, not for every other interest. The development interest, the bank's interest, the tourist interest. That's not the interest.
And that's what people are afraid of. Atlanta's changing to the point.
It's got to change to a place that really loves people. And we can do it because we have enough land. We have enough potential if we design it properly. And it's going to require a neighborhood development strategy with non-displacement built in its core as a philosophy. And all economic incentives and all rezonings require affordability to be a part of it. I'm the only person of all the candidates that's actually delivered affordable housing.
Yes.
So we have 80 new units that we just announced and dedicated on Boulevard. And we've got two more projects coming by the same developer. This is within the Wingate footprint in Bedford Pines, but I also have a 22-story development on the corner of Boulevard and Highland Avenue, across from the CVS. This is next to the nurse's building, and it's going to be a mixed-income hotel, condo, and low-income housing. Why is it low-income? Because the developers are Canadian, so they don't mind living next to people who don't have a lot, and they're okay with, I'm like, where's your janitor going to live? Where's the security guard going to live? And they're even integrating veteran housing into this development. We just passed it today.
Wow.
So we're really doing innovative things. That development is going to be called something like integration or inclusion. That's going to be the name of it. Not viewpoint, but inclusion.
That's news tonight on Newsmakers Live. That's interesting. But isn't it something of a conundrum, though, between needed neighborhood development and enhancement versus displacement? I mean, it seems like we want our neighborhoods to get better. We want to reduce crime, but we don't want to be pushed out when it does.
That's right. And people shouldn't be pushed out. People should be able to enjoy a neighborhood coming back and being the nice place that they finally can walk in and not have to lock themselves inside every time they get to their door and be afraid that someone may come up and snatch their purse, like what happened on Cahaba Drive last night or a few nights ago where I grew up. So, you know, you really don't want to have development that doesn't include everyone. The rising tide should lift everybody up. And there were seniors who enjoyed the benefits of the change of this neighborhood and some families in Old Fourth Ward. But there are not enough of those examples in other parts of our city. One of the things missing is we're going to have to bring back a community development network, a community development corporation. Like we had HDDC in the Old Fourth Ward, we're going to have to build them out in Westview and West End. So the price points are, so the CDC acts as an agent on behalf of the interests of the community so that the development interests don't just dominate. Because if they dominate, the market will drive everything, and the prices will be $300,000 within a year or a year and a half. We don't want that to happen.
The Turner Field area is another spot of speculation and fear that many people who live there now will be displaced. Is this going to become the germane issue, the main issue you think of this mayor's race?
I think neighborhoods, affordability, neighborhoods, and the ability to balance development and protect neighborhoods is a mission-critical thing for the city, and it has to be our agenda. Community benefits agreements are something that I believe in. Now, as council members, we tend to have a courtesy amongst council members to, you know, you work within your district and you do your thing. In District 2, we've had developers who've done workforce training. We've done everything in terms of a community benefit that this, the neighborhood around Turner Field is asking for, Summerhill and Peoplestown, but we were able to work it out. Personally, as mayor, every deal would be a deal with the community benefit locked in because they can be done if you choose to. And there are organizations like the Annie Casey Foundation that I've been working with for about a year, year and a half, that have created infrastructure where you can use a bank, you can use a hospital, you can use a college as the partner institution, that anchor institution that helps to ensure that the benefits actually accrue to the community. So I have no problem with community benefits, and I've already delivered on some. So many of the young women who live on Boulevard, like I said, there are 700 families, had an opportunity to work at Ponce City Market on the construction site.
Oh, wow.
So we gave them jobs. Initially, the developers didn't want to do it, but I pushed them and said, we need to do this. And they said, you're right, Kwanzaa. So they stepped in. We probably gave about 100 jobs to young women and training who lived on Boulevard, plus other people in the community. From there, they went to work on the Forest North America site. Then they went to the stadium. So this is portability, portable skills that you can take around. But it was just a request. I said, hey, we need to do this.
Right.
But going forward, developers in District 2 are agreeing to a voluntary community benefits concept with minority participation, economic inclusion around jobs and job training, just all kinds of things you can do to support a community. In Emmett Park, developments like any kind of development is going to generally have some kind of benefit that accrues to the community, to the preschool, to the community school that's in the neighborhood. They want some sidewalks added. They want additional support for the safety patrol. If you don't ask for it, you don't get it.
Right.
But you also have to know how to negotiate. I think sometimes we only focus on the protest approach, and that can be partially effective. But if you know how to really negotiate, that's not the only way to get what you need. And you don't get what you deserve, you get what you negotiate. But it's the responsibility of people like me to make sure that when people come asking, I know what the community needs.
That's right.
And I say, I want y'all to deliver this back. I'll support you. Actually, instead of your building being that tall, I'll make it this tall.
Mm-hmm.
But can you make sure the local people get some jobs? Would you let some of them stay in your building? Can they clean it up now? Can the kids take off the graffiti? I mean, so then they're like, oh yeah, I never thought about that. Once we could. I'm saying, you do want them to be a part of the neighborhood, they're going to be robbing everybody, right? Sure, you're right. And, you know, and I actually know someone who has an ice cream shop around the corner.
Makes sense.
Yeah, kind of. Like they have an ice cream shop around the corner. They want to be in your ground floor. Or they on the, in the west side and they want to have an opportunity to present their cupcake company. So that's that intentionality has to be a part of every conversation, every negotiation, because that's my job to make sure that not just this side gets what they need, but everybody else who doesn't have a seat at the table and those who don't have a voice in the conversation.
We are a common friend of ours says, if you don't have a seat at the table, you're just on the menu.
That's right.
And you're going to get chewed up.
That's right.
Listen, two more questions, please.
Sure.
One, we've had a black mayor in this town since Maynard Jackson, since 72. There's some who argue this may be the last time, may be the last one. You have a Mary Norwood, Pete Ammon, others. Where are we racially in this town? Are we still as tense and racially polarized as we had been? Or is the tide tipping toward the fact that the city is ready for a white leadership?
I don't think the city's looking for a black mayor, a white mayor, a gay mayor, nor a straight mayor. The city wants a great mayor, a mayor who will be a mayor for everybody. And that's what I'm saying. I will be the mayor for everybody.
That's what your poster says,
and,
right?
You know, so
everybody's
some,
mayor?
You know, there are some people who are... speaking from the voice of, we're disenfranchised in Buckhead, so we want a candidate. We're the old guard. Mm-hmm. Or another person saying, I'm the new guard of the business community, and we want to have our interests met, because you're not speaking to our interests. There are people in Southwest Atlanta saying, we want to keep it just like it has been, because we've been doing all right for the last 40 years. Then there are people in the in-town neighborhood who are just mad because they feel both of those groups have been cutting deals on the backs of poor people, on the backs of well-heeled urbanists who live in town. And then there are people who are living on the margins who are feeling like no one cares about me.
That's true.
And I've touched every one of those groups. There's the LGBT community that feels like no one's speaking to their interests. But Atlanta actually does, because we pretty much are, you know, checking all the boxes on the issues that have been germane in the city. The state might be different and the nation might be different, but in the city of Atlanta. So that's why I say it's not, if you want to be divided, you can choose to be in those divided groups. Or you can think inclusively about what are the common things that we all have as a problem. The things we all want are a safe city, a clean city, a city that educates our children, a city that doesn't push everyone out, that has affordable housing in it, and transportation that gets you where you need to go. And there's an opportunity for upward mobility wherever you start. That's what everybody's asking for. But we're talking about, I just want to keep it black, or I want to make it white, because a white person would be a better leader, or a black person isn't a good leader. We know those are not true. But that's the easy place to go as human beings.
Right.
And
you
that's hear not what my candidacy is about, because we've already delivered that. We've proven that. I'm representing a district that is less than 23% African-American.
For years.
So it has nothing to do with black and white in terms of who will vote for you. It has something to do with what you're delivering and what you're offering.
And you think the bulk of your vote, your electorate will be here in this district?
I think, you know, the District 2 turned out 23,000 votes in the last presidential race, more than any other district in the city.
Wow.
So I think we are positioned uniquely compared to others. This is a new, moving, dynamic, well-educated, excited group. And then you have old school people like Ms. Mills who live over here. And then if you spread out to other neighborhoods just a little further out, you go to Cabbage Town and Ormwood Park and Grant Park and, you know, North Midtown, and you go to West Midtown, you're kind of touching the same kind of people. Virginia Highlands, same kind of people. I think all of them are asking for the same thing. But I grew up in Southwest Atlanta.
Right.
I used to hang out on Camelton Road, you know. That's my old stomping ground. Every street over there, from Adamsville to, you know, Mason Turner, that's where I grew up. So I know people in all those little nooks and crannies as well. And then you go to Buckhead, all these buildings, who do you think finances them? Who do you think? Hey, now, John, you might like your candidate who lives near you. You might like the business guy. But who actually has helped you? Who actually delivered when you had nobody to call you? Who'd you call? So now people in Atlanta haven't really dealt with the matrix or the concept of loyalty as a model for how our city should be governed. So we right now don't really demonstrate that we treat people who treated us right, right. I think that's a little bit off in the city, and we need to change our culture around that, because loyalty as a value system really makes it easier to engage.
Will the mayor endorse you? Do you think you have his support? And is that even needed?
Well, you know, honestly, I'll welcome any endorsement that anybody offers me, okay? I'll take any endorsement I can get my hands on. I haven't talked to the mayor about an endorsement. I've called and talked to several other mayors, former mayors and mayors in other cities and, you know, council members. So I'm talking to everybody, and I want your endorsement too if I can have it. I know you're a media. But I'm open to his support if he'll offer it. I mean, I think he has been a strong mayor.
Really?
Not everyone likes him or agrees with his personality, but he's worked really hard, and it's not an easy job to deliver very strong finances, number one, for the city. I mean, the books are good. We have almost $170 million in the bank. That's 20% of our annual budget. Okay, so 20%. If you make $100,000, you got $20,000 in the bank at least. Okay? If you make $30,000, you got $6,000 in the bank. So he's got that much in the bank, and that's been our commitment from a council to city leadership. But he hadn't raided it. He hadn't tried to go spend it. He believes in that concept. So that is a really good position to be in. And then now he's helped raise the $50 million to deal with homelessness around Peachtree and Pine. I think that's been, you know, admirable leadership. We've got to deal with it. We haven't figured it out, but we need to deal with it. So I think he is trying to deliver on some very ambitious things. And, you know, I give him credit. We were not always on the same page. And,
that's what I thought.
So to be able to transition from a place of not being on the same page and having a rapport and a dialogue with a very strong and tough person on both sides of the table says a lot about me, but it also says a lot about him.
His recognition of your clout and your influence.
And likewise, I mean, you know, he is the mayor. I'm a councilman. And we're in what's called strong mayor, weak council. Right. The mayor has, I mean, you might think council members have power, but we really only have about 40% of the power, if at best, when we're all together, and it takes 10 of us. Right. Imagine getting 10 people to agree on an issue and to hold a line and vote on it more than once. Generally, you don't see the council overturning a veto. The same thing you see in Washington. When the power is shifted, you don't see that vote going one way or the other because the president has the power. If the president doesn't have the power, then you see the shift. In Atlanta, it's designed by charter that the mayor has most of the power. They appoint most of the committee, I mean, most of the commission. I mean, everyone in the city reports to the mayor except, let me make it easy, except for the police. Everyone in the mayor reports to the mayor except for the finance department and the law department. So everybody else is his direct report, and he can fire them pretty much.
And will, right.
So if I say I want police over here, I can say that. But if I don't have a relationship with the mayor, a relationship with the chief, a relationship with the deputies, a relationship with the zone commander, I might not be able to get that responsiveness like it's needed. Not that people don't want to deliver, but if you don't have relationships in life, what happens? People don't call you back as fast because they think you're not somebody who's trying to be warm and fuzzy with them. Right?
That's true.
So relationships do matter. I want to say one thing to the audience. You got to make friends before you need them. Okay? Don't try to call people when you need something. You don't already know them. Have a little, hey, I've already given you some. I've helped you. You know, I know I've delivered something for you. So, hey, man, can I call you? Now, remember who helped you, too, though.
Yeah.
You know? So, sorry.
Finally, that's good stuff. Finally, where it looked like we're in a political shift in Atlanta. It's going to be virtually a new council. Many of you all are running for office. Two council members are running for city council president. We have a young man coming behind you who wants to fill your seat. Are we in a new political day in Atlanta?
I think we're at Mayor Reed's administration is the end of an era. It's the end of the era of the old guard Atlanta that I grew up with, being the absolute decider. And I think we're looking forward to a broader, more diverse coalition, kind of like what Maynard saw in the very beginning of his election, because it required a broad coalition. That's what's going to happen as we go forward, a broader coalition that's more diverse. But leadership has to be committed to doubling down on inclusion and breaking down some of the silos. Atlanta is extremely segregated and equally as disappointing in how the segregation hurts us. People grew up in the Buckhead, they never really get to enjoy what it's like to live in Southwest Atlanta.
That's true.
If you grow up in Southwest Atlanta, go to a great school like Mays High School, where I went, where I was president of Mays. But I remember, and I see Amir out there, we went to Galloway, and we did math counts, and we competed against them, and we beat them, okay? But that's the only time we ever interacted. There was no engagement. So the isolation and the segregation is terrible.
It still exists.
Yeah, we're allowing it to, and you can't meet someone at 20 and 30 and have the same type of relationship that you would have if you met them when you were 5, 6, 7, 8. I remember all my friends from my little league football team because we learned everything about being a person at that time. And whatever we learned then, we carried all the way up. And if you don't have any diversity,
all the way to MIT or wherever, right?
All the way to MIT. But if I really fall on the ground, I get back up because one of those guys pulled me up, right? So I think there's something to us really diversifying the experience that our young people have and that families have, and really just getting out of these silos. It's so comfortable to go to 285 and just go to Applebee's or go to Cricket's and do that every day over and over and over and be comfortable with that and never meet someone on the other side. And it's equally as much as comfortable to go to the Blue Ridge Grill,
right,
and go there every day and be comfortable.
Sweet Auburn seafood.
Live your whole life and never meet other people till you're 55 years old. I mean, we're missing so much, let alone if we travel and take advantage of this global airport amenity that we have.
And you think you can change that?
Yeah, I think we can. Atlanta's only 500,000 people.
But I mean, you as a leader.
Absolutely. I'm going to bring everybody together. I'm going to have the best parties. Everybody's going to get to know each other. I'm going to be like, what? We love Atlanta now. And then I'm going to bring my international friends back to hang with you. And then when you go to another country, you check in. You let us know where you're going. You just got to represent Atlanta well. But we'll plug you in with people in other cities who will help you have the experience of your life like you would want them to have about Atlanta. See, we really know how to put on, but we haven't been focused on being our absolute best because we're not really including people. It's all the other interests are driving us. And we got to let our love of people drive us. And that's going to make this city a whole nother place.
We got a whole nother guy who wanted to be the mayor of Atlanta. His name is Kwanzaa Hall, councilman, born and raised here in Atlanta. He's ubiquitous. He's seen everywhere with all sorts of folks. And he wants to create a new Atlanta. Thank you for being here, sir.
Thank you.
Now, Jim, welcome.
This is what it's all about. I've lived in the Fourth Ward since I came to Atlanta. And this man has been my councilman, and he's always been accessible. And I'm always calling for something. I don't always get what I want, but I get a conversation. I can't say that about other people in City Hall. I think this man may be our next mayor. I think this man should be our next mayor. At the end of the day, Atlanta needs diversity. It needs to do exactly what he just said. It needs to talk to everybody everywhere. And Newsmakers Live has always been an African-American interest program. But an Afro-American interest program does not mean an all-black program. Because many of the things that are important to African-Americans
awesome.
Are not on our side of the street. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been Newsmakers.